be with you this morning from this station mass in this rather magnificent church. We are in the middle of Lent, and Lent is a time of grace. Looking forward to Easter, to the Easter Triduum. The Easter Triduum turns into the 50 days of Eastertide, so 40 days of Lent, 3 days of the Paschal Easter Triduum, and 50 days of Lent, 40 plus 3 plus 50. And all of it a time of grace. I think it's good just to think that God, our Father, the Heavenly Father, he has something for us during this time. Now, we can't second guess that. We can't say what that might be for each of us individually. But we can career into a nice broad generalization. And we can say this, that what is it that God the Father would most wish us to have? Well, surely it would be his Son, let us say, a deeper realization of who his Son is. This is my Son, the Beloved. We heard that the other Sunday, the Sunday of the Transfiguration. We hear it at the account of Jesus' baptism. God the Father didn't say that with a yawn, you know, here it is, you know, please listen to him. This is right from the burning heart of God. This is my Son, the Beloved. Listen to him. You know, take him into your lives. He is what I want to give you. The Jews, the Jewish rabbis, have a very Jewish thing with a sort of mixture of humor and depth to it. And they ask the question, what is God doing? What does God do in heaven? How, to put it humanly, does God fill his days? And he gave this droll answer, reading the Torah, reading the law of Moses. God, as it were, studying the law as he wanted the Jews to. But, you know, in a way that's just crazy, of course, but there's a deeper level to it, that in the Jewish mind, and we heard that in the first reading and it comes out again in the Gospel, the law was God's great creation and his great gift to humanity after creation itself. To crown creation, he gives his beloved people the law. And so he himself is, as it were, wondering at the beauty of this law that he has created. He looked on creation and he says, behold, it is very good. And he looks on the law. But most of all, from our perspective, he is looking on his beloved Son. He is reading, he is gazing at, he is loving his Son. And this is the gift he wants to give us. I remember she really was a holy lady, Elgin, and she wasn't at all given to strange experiences and things like that, but she had one of these near-death experiences in a dental chair in Elgin, and she, for a moment or so, she died. And when she returned, she said, what was left with her? Was this, if only I had known, only I had known, not about her sins, but, from what I understood from what she said, but of who Christ is, who the Son of God is. If only I had known, if only I had known this gift of love, if only I had fully realized it. So there it is. Now, we turn to the Gospel. If this is the Father's gift, if the Father wishes to give us Son so that we know him, love him, serve him more. Where do we go? We go to the gospel. And today, Jesus, speaking as a Jew to the Jews, is saying, do not imagine, don't even begin to think that I have come to abolish the law and the prophets. He's about to say some pretty radical things in the Sermon on the Mount. He said, don't misinterpret. And then he says, I have come not to abolish, but to complete them. I have come not to abolish, but to complete them. Now, whenever Jesus says, I have come, we should sit up. Because he is saying, this is why I'm here. He's not saying, I've just come from Nazareth to Capernaum to tell you this. He's saying, this is my mission, this is my identity, this is why I'm here with you and among you to do this. So, the gospel is full of these things. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. I must go on to the other villages and preach the good news there, because for this I have come. The Son of Man has come to seek and to save what is lost. So when Jesus says, I have come, sit up. And so here he says, I have come not to abolish, not to destroy, but to complete. Now, we always translate that, and in a way in English you have to say this. He said, I don't think I've come to abolish the law and the prophets. I have come not to abolish, but to complete them. But he doesn't actually say that. He just says, I have come not to destroy, but to fulfill, but to complete. It's a general statement. He is speaking as a Jew to the Jews, for whom the law, this law that God himself spends heaven reading, this law was the center of their life, the love of their life. And Jesus is saying, I haven't come to abolish this gift of my Father, but I've come to bring it to fruit, to fruition, to fulfill it, to fill it full. But we can expand this, because we're not Jews. We are Gentiles. And what have we got? We've just got, in a sense, our poor humanity. We've got the gift of creation. And here we are, each of us, pretty fragile, very fragile. Really, being alive is like holding a candle in a hurricane, honestly. We build tents around ourselves to stop it being blown out. But we know how vulnerable we are, how easily our life can be extinguished. And yet it's all we've got, this little flame of life. For how long a time, we don't know. One among millions of human beings, past, present, and to come. And Jesus says, I have come not to abolish, but to destroy. We can turn the then that we hear in the gospel into you. I have come not to abolish you, not to destroy you, not to blow out your candle, but to fulfill it. To turn it perhaps into a blaze of light. You are the light of the world. He's just said that. And you see, we are scared. Because it's part of our fallen condition that God comes to us, Christ comes to us as a threat in some way. We do think we've got our freedom, our little life, our loves, our desires, our hopes. And we feel that God is a rival, God is a competitor, God will blow out my candle. Jesus is trying to assure us that he isn't. Now this is all a very paradoxical and bewildering business. It's quite beyond me, quite beyond me to explain it. But think of Jesus himself in the Garden of Gethsemane. Think of Jesus on the cross saying, my God, why have you forsaken me? Feeling his cap being blown out by the Father who surely loves him. And yet, it's on the cross that we get this same word coming back, completely fulfilled. It is accomplished. It's the same word. On the cross, he says, it is accomplished. He has reached his fulfillment, his human nature, on the cross. Well, why? How? Because he has loved to the end, because he has made a perfect gift of himself. But maybe, just, you know, this is the word for today's gospel. Maybe we can just take that home, take it to ourselves. I have come not to abolish, not to destroy you, but to complete you, to fulfill you in ways that will pass through the cross, through the resurrection, in ways that will be bewildering, in ways that will seem to be leading in the other direction, and yet will not. Just to end with three quick testimonies to that. sometime in the second century, we keep them in the calendar of saints, the Bishop of Smyrna, Saint Polycarp, was martyred, and he was an 86-year-old man when he came to be put to death. And he was on trial and he was told, well, put the grains of incense before the image of Caesar, or whatever, deny Christ. And he said something very beautiful. He said, for 86 years, I have served the Lord, and he has never done me any harm. How can I deny him? He has never done me any harm. I have come not to abolish, but to destroy. Jump through 17 centuries, and you come to John Henry Newman, who also lived to a great age, to 89, and he said at some point towards the end of his life, I can say now, from a full heart, at the end of a long life, that God has never failed me, never disappointed me, always turned evil into good for me. I have come not to abolish, but to fulfill. And then, last testimony, beautiful thing, just a little paragraph and then a regular end. The homily that Pope Benedict gave when he became Pope in 2005, already an old man, I think he's 70s. And this is the end of it, I think it's exquisite stuff. And he's talking about do not fear. Be not afraid. And he says, are we not perhaps all afraid in some way? If we let Christ enter fully into our lives, if we open ourselves totally to him, are we not afraid that he might take something away from us? Are we not perhaps afraid to give up something significant, something unique, something that makes life so beautiful? Do we not then risk ending up diminished, deprived of our freedom? No. If we let Christ into our lives, we lose nothing, nothing, absolutely nothing of what makes life free, beautiful, and great. No. Only in this friendship are the doors of life opened wide. Only in this friendship is the great potential human existence truly revealed. Only in this friendship do we experience beauty and liberation. And so today, with great strength and great conviction, on the basis of long personal experience of life, I say to you, do not be afraid of Christ. He takes nothing away, and he gives you everything. When we give ourselves to him, we receive a hundredfold in return. Yes, open wide the doors to Christ.